Hello people, in this video let us look at esophagoscopy. So what are we trying to look at? We are trying to examine what? The esophagus. So they are putting an endoscope here and they are trying to see whatever they can see in the esophagus. Okay, so here they have a monitor on which they are seeing. Here they have put it via the mouth, examining the esophagus, usually under anesthesia, you can say. Okay. So, there are different types of esophagoscopy, guys. You have rigid esophagoscopy, flexible and transnasal. So, the rigid one, actually, that will require this one, rigid one, this will require general anesthesia. Okay, you can see how straight these tubes are, right? And then you have the flexible fiber optic esophagoscopy. The flexible one basically is using fiber optics, right? It is going to be flexible. And this they can use just with some local anesthetic, okay? And here they are showing you flexible fiber optic esophagoscopy. They can do it outdoors also, they are saying. Okay, no need to go to the operation theater. And then lastly, they are talking about transnasal esophagoscopy. The transnasal one again uses the same technology, fiber optic flexible, but here they are going via the nose. Okay, so basically what difference you have to know here is this rigid esophagoscopy, they are not doing now. This is almost obsolete. Okay, what they are using now is flexible fiber optic esophagoscopy, but only if there is some foreign body which is impacted kind of a thing, or a big foreign body, or if it is kind of hard, then they are using rigid esophagoscopy. For everything else, you can almost use flexible fiber optic esophagoscopy. So guys, look at this, rigid versus flexible. Whatever we told you, same thing only we have marked here. You can see here. Rigid one, which they're not doing so much now, you need general anesthesia, you need to go via the mouth, right? You cannot do it wherever there is jaw and neck abnormality, because you see the rod is so straight, right? Then you can see only esophagus, guys. Up to esophagus only you can see in this rigid one. Flexible, you can see esophagus, stomach, pylorus, everything. What is the other thing? Even duodenum you can see with flexible one, but rigid one only esophagus. Okay, foreign body removal is very easy with the rigid one. This is the main point here. You have to focus only for foreign body removal. This rigid, they are kind of recommending. It requires admission, guys. This person has to be admitted. So, it will cost will be more. They have to go to operation theater to give general anesthesia, etc. Accessories, like basically, you will not be able to take video kind of a thing. Documentation is difficult. It requires telescopes for magnification. Okay. Documentation is difficult. They are saying cost is more. Cost is more because this is requiring admission. Otherwise, why cost is more? Operation theater cost. Okay. Then coming to flexible one, guys. Let us become flexible, guys. Flexible. Let's be flexible. So, they are using fiber optic esophagoscopy here. Basically, you can use topical anesthesia with sedation. You can go via the mouth or nose. So, there will be transnasal esophagoscopy. Usually, for diagnostic things, they are saying. And here you can do even in jaw and neck abnormalities. You can not only see the esophagus, you can see the stomach, the pylorus, even the duodenum. It is an outdoor procedure, no need to go into the operation theater. You can remove foreign bodies, but only which are soft and small. Otherwise, foreign body is really unsheathing. They are not very keen on the flexible one is not for foreign body removal. Usually foreign body removal, they are recommending rigid esophagoscopy. And this thing of flexible fiber optic one, it will have inbuilt facility of camera. So, you can have bright light, magnification, easy documentation also. Reduced cost. Cost is less. You're not going to operation theater. You're not admitting the person. Okay. So, nowadays flexible only, they're doing for everything. See, this is the esophagoscope. You can see here. Compare it with a bronchoscope. This is a bronchoscope here. This is an esophagoscope. So, basically esophagoscope will not have the holes. Can you see some holes here in bronchoscope? So, basically, there will be holes which help in ventilation. But this esophagoscope which you are using, basically, based on the age, you will have different lengths. Guys, focus. Okay, there is no holes, basically. This one, whatever they are showing you here is a negus, negus, N-E-G-U-S. It's written here, see. Negus esophagoscope it is. Okay. So, you will have method of illumination the same as that of laryngoscope. Handle at the proximal end, there is a handle at the proximal end, and it will show you the direction of the bevel at the distal end. So this handle will show you the direction of the bevel at the distal end. At the distal bevel is there, right? It will show you the direction. The handle will show you the direction. Did everything go above your head, guys? What did you just look at? Esophagoscope. Did you compare it with what? Bronchoscope. Very good. Let's continue then. Rigid esophagoscopy indications. Why will you do this? So basically, if somebody has difficulty in swallowing, dysphagia, if they have some cancer of the esophagus, achalasia, cardia, because this lower esophageal sphincter, some problem, right? Achalasia. So basically, these people, the sphincter won't open and all, right? The stomach will be, the food will remain in the esophagus. That's dangerous, right?
Achalasia.
Yeah, that's achalasia.
Achalasia.
Strictures can be there, esophagitis, diverticulae. See this? They are seeing something here at the lower end of the esophagus. Some kind of stricture or something. So for all this, you will use, as diagnostic purpose, you can use this rigid esophagoscopy. Okay, they're talking with the rigid one here. Okay, to find the cause of retrosternal burning. So behind your sternum, it's burning, is it? So there can be reflux esophagitis, hiatus hernia. What is this hiatus hernia, guys? Hiatus hernia, you can see here, the stomach itself is coming, some part of it to outside from the diaphragm. This condition, if it is there, again, there can be retrosternal burning behind the sternum, isn't it? What happened? It went missing, that thing, hiatus hernia, yeah. Okay, so hiatus hernia, we finished. All this can cause retrosternal burning. So if somebody has retrosternal burning, you can do, right? What can you do? Rigid esophagoscopy, diagnostically, to find out what the problem is. Okay, then hematemesis, if they are vomiting blood, right, you can find out why. Like esophageal varices can be there, they are vomiting blood. So you can do some diagnosis. Secondary is neck with unknown primary. So there is something happening in the neck, but you don't know what the cause is. Like, then you can do it as a part of panendoscopy. Okay. So that's diagnostic, guys. If you're not able to swallow, if you have retrosternal burning, if you have hematemesis, if you have some secondaries in the neck without the known primary, you can do rigid esophagoscopy. Therapeutically, to remove foreign body, this is very important. Don't forget, therapeutically removing foreign body, dilatation in case of esophageal strictures or cardiac achalasia. There's a stricture, this lower sphincter is not opening, dilated. How can you dilate it? Put that rigid esophagoscope. Endoscopic removal of benign lesion. You can also remove not only foreign body, any lesion is there also you can remove, like fibroma, papilloma, cysts. Okay, remove it. Remove whatever you want to remove, and you can remove. Okay, guys, then insertion of Sotar's or Mosu Barbin tube in palliative treatment of esophageal carcinoma. What is this? This name itself is so strange. Guys, here they are talking about some palliative treatment for esophageal carcinoma using some tubes. Okay, look at these tubes. Some
Sutars or Musobarbin tube.
Sutar tube or Musobarbin tube. Listen again.
Musobarbin tube.
This is the Musobarbin tube. Okay. And this one is the what tube, guys? Can you see the name?
Tube.
What tube?
Sutars tube. Sutars.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, thank you. Injection of esophageal varices means what? Varices means what? Varicose vein. So they are injecting it, is it? So guys, so did you understand all the indications, guys? Hiatus hernia, dysphagia, retrosternal burning, hematemesis, remove foreign body, dilatation if there is any stricture, remove benign lesions also you can remove, then if there is carcinoma of esophagus, you can insert some tubes. Sautar's tube or what is the other tube? Mosu Barron's tube. Okay, you have to write these names if they are Sautar's tube, Mosu Barron's tube. Then injection of esophageal varices. Okay, so then coming corrosive burns of esophagus, what will you do? You will not pass the esophagus beyond the first severe circumferential burn. You will not go beyond the burn. First severe circumferential burn, you will not go beyond that. Okay, that's all you can know. Okay. Then, what are they doing here with the esophagus, esophagoscopy? To know if the burns have occurred, to know if the burns have occurred, that's all. Within 2 days, they are doing to know if the burns have occurred. But if there is burns and they see it is severe and circumferential, they will not go beyond it. Benign strictures of esophagus, if there is stricture, we told you, what will they do? They will dilate. This is a treatment, remember. This is a therapeutic. They can dilate with bogies. What is bogies? Prograde dilatation with bogies. This is that flexible thing which with which they can dilate. This is bogie. Bogies, okay? And then that's the treatment for strictures of esophagus. Then you can remove foreign body, especially rigid esophagoscopy you can do. And you can remove with esophagoscopy. Rigid esophagoscopy you can do. And you can do flexible esophagoscopy for soft things and blunt things. Soft and blunt, they are saying you can do. Soft and blunt objects. Guys, focus here. So, rigid you can do for removing foreign body. You will have to have the proper size and type of forceps, etc. Soft, if it is like meat pieces without bone, it will be soft, right? Vegetable matter. Blunt object you can remove with flexible. But if it is hard or if it is sharp, maybe you have to use rigid esophagoscope, okay? So, rigid esophagoscope, when you won't do. Guys, if you remember in that comparison we already saw, right? If there is joint neck abnormality, you will not do rigid esophagoscopy. Flexible you can do. So, can you say the contraindications of rigid esophagoscopy now? Trismus. If there's locked jaw, you cannot do rigid esophagoscopy, obviously. Then, can you do if there is disease of cervical spine, like cervical traumas, spondylitis? No, rigid one you can't do. Tuberculous spine, osteophytes, kyphosis, you cannot do. Then, all this will make rigid esophagoscopy technically difficult. Flexible fiber optic esophagoscopy you can do. If there is a receding mandible, you will not do rigid one. Aneurysm of aorta, fear of rupture, fatal hemorrhage. If there is aorta aneurysm, don't do rigid esophagoscopy. There can be rupture and even fatal hemorrhage. Person can die because of your rigid esophagoscope. Aneurysm of aorta, be very, very careful. Okay. Then, advanced heart, liver, kidney disease may be relative contraindication. It's a relative contraindication if these people have some other heart, liver, kidney conditions. Okay. So, can you say when you should not do esophagoscopy, rigid one? When you should not do? Try to recollect and say, guys.
Trismus.
Yeah.
Disease of cervical spine.
Yeah.
Receding mandible.
Okay.
Aneurysm of aorta.
Okay.
Advanced heart, liver or kidney disease.
Very good. Trismus, cervical spine problem, mandible receding, aneurysm of aorta, heart, liver, kidney disease can be a relative contraindication. Very good. Then, let's move on. Anesthesia, usually for rigid you will give general. Local you can give for fiber optic. Okay. Rigid esophagoscopy position. Position, look at it guys. The patient will be supine. So, let's make him supine. Please lie supine. Okay. Head is elevated by 10 to 15 centimeter. Neck is flexed. That means neck is flexed on chest. Right? So, kind of look down when you're sitting now. Yeah. Touch your chest with your neck. Okay. Chin. Head is extended at atlanto-occipital joint. So, head is extended. But neck is flexed. Okay. The purpose of this is to obtain the axis of the mouth, pharynx and esophagus in a straight line as to pass the rigid tube easily. Position can be achieved with the help of an assistant or a special headrest. Guys, do you think this photo is correctly depicting the position? Because they have kept some pillow here and some headrest and this seems to be a straight line. Okay. Okay, then this is the same as direct laryngoscopy position. Okay. Then, technique, how will you do? So, they placing a piece of gauze over the upper teeth. Okay, over the upper teeth to protect the teeth. Okay, dental guard. Esophagoscope is lubricated with the swab or autoclave liquid paraffin or jelly. So, you put some jelly so that you lubricate this esophagoscope. Okay, you will keep a gauze on the teeth. Upper teeth, you will keep some gauze. Okay, to protect them. Then you are lubricating your esophagoscope. Then esophagoscope is held by its proximal end in like a pen-like fashion. You should hold it and introduce it into the mouth by the right side of the tongue. How will you introduce it? By the right side of the tongue, guys. And then towards the middle of its dorsum. Okay, let's move on. We're not going into much details here. There are four basic steps they're saying. You have to identify the arytenoids. Okay. Identify the arytenoids from inside. Here we are showing you from outside arytenoids. Then you have to go some pass the cricopharyngeal sphincter. Okay. Then cross the aortic arch and the left bronchus. So you will go cross the aortic arch and the left bronchus they are talking about. And then you have to pass the cardia. Oh my god. Till here is it. That's the stomach. Till there you have to go. Okay. Passing the cardia. Cardia is identified by its redder and more velvety rugose mucosa. Cardia is what? It's the stomach, right? Stomach's cardia, right? Stomach part. Yeah, that's right. See, here you have cardia. Part of the stomach. Okay. So you can identify easily because you will see the rugae. Cardia is identified by its redder and more velvety rugae mucosa. Rugose mucosa. Okay. Easy, right? Guys, just telling, you just go through this and you can see more information. As of now, we are not going into the details. Never forget to inspect the esophageal wall when you're removing the esophagus. When you're removing the esophagoscope, again examine the wall, okay? Just don't pull it out. Once we are going, you have checked. But when you're coming back also, you check. That's what they are saying, okay? Post-operative care, they are saying, because this was done in operation theater. No, guys, this is not a small thing, rigid esophagoscopy, right? Now, let's look at the post-operative care. Post-operative care, guys, basically, what are they saying here? Sips of plain water followed by usual diet may be given. So, plain water, usual diet can be given if it is an uneventful esophagoscopy. You watch the patient for pain in the interscapular region. In the interscapular region, you should watch for pain, surgical emphysema of neck and abrupt rise in temperature. What is this abrupt rise in temperature? Does it mean infection or something? They indicate in esophageal perforation. Oh my God. So you went to do esophagoscopy and you created a perforation now. Okay. What are the complications? You can injure the lips and teeth. That's why they said put the gauze on the upper teeth, right? Then you can enjoy the arytenoids. That's why they say identify the arytenoids and go. Then pharyngeal mucosa you can injure. You can perforate the esophagus. It more happens at the site of the Killehan's dehiscence, near the cricopharyngeal sphincter. That's why they told you cricopharyngeal sphincter, very careful. So whenever they told you the technique, now they told you go identify this, right? Then surgical emphysema can develop within an hour or so, and the person can he'll complain of pain where in the interscapular region. Where is the scapula? Scapula, interscapular region. Here he will complain of pain. Okay. Then, can you say when will you get this pain?
Interscapular region pain. Rigid esophagoscopy.
Perfect. In rigid esophagoscopy. Compression of trachea. And this compression of trachea can happen especially in children. You have to immediately withdraw the esophagoscope. Remember, immediately you have to withdraw esophagoscope. Where will they usually perforate the esophagus during rigid esophagoscopy? Killehan's dehiscence, right? This one, this triangle here. Between the cricopharyngeus and the thyropharyngeus. This cricopharyngeus, remember, that is why they told you, you have to be careful. Just last two slides, guys. Focus here, flexible fiber optic esophagoscopy. It is now the they do flexible more than this rigid. Rigid they use only for removing foreign object. This one, flexible one, outdoor procedure. You just need some topical anesthesia with sedative. You can see not only esophagus, you can see stomach, duodenum, etc. You can see mucosal diseases nicely. Okay. Then, coming to transnasal esophagoscopy, the same fiber optic one, they are performing through nose. Okay. So, they can air also, they have to inflate. So, this flexible fibroscope will have a working channel of 2 mm and the air also can be inflated through it. Okay. You can examine up to gastric fundus. You cannot go to duodenum and all that, but yeah, you can examine the gastric fundus. So, here they are telling about the larynx also. You can take laryngeal biopsy, it seems in this. Laryngeal biopsy you can take. So, you can perform the tracheoesophageal puncture for esophageal speech in a laryngectomized patient. So, in a patient who has his larynx removed, so there is a laryngectomized patient, in that guy you can do a tracheoesophageal puncture. You yourself are creating a hole between the trachea and the esophagus because this person will need speech. So, that's it about transnasal esophagoscopy. Let's take a recap, guys. In this video, we wanted to look at esophagoscopy to examine the esophagus. There are three types of esophagoscopy, the rigid one, the flexible fiber optic esophagoscopy, and the transnasal esophagoscopy. So what they do currently mostly is the flexible fiber optic esophagoscopy. Rigid one, they're usually using only to remove some foreign objects, okay? And that to the hard ones or the sharp ones, then only they're using the rigid esophagoscopy. Transnasal esophagoscopy, whenever they want to take some laryngeal biopsy, etc., they're going via the nose. Basically, the flexible fiber optic esophagoscopy, you can not only see the esophagus, you can see the stomach, even the duodenum you can see, okay? So that is what is the advantage of this fiber flexible fiber optic esophagoscopy. So as you can see here, the flexible fiber optic esophagoscopy, you can do that in topical anesthesia. You can even go orally or nasally. You can see esophagus, stomach, pylorus and the duodenum. You can it's an outdoor procedure. You don't need to go to operation theater because you are anyways using only topical anesthesia. You can remove only some small soft foreign bodies, etc. You cannot remove impacted foreign body, and there is camera, etc., so you can have easy documentation, and even the cost is less. So flexible, okay? But in the exam they will ask you rigid esophagoscopy, right? So you should know that this is how you will do. You will do it under general anesthesia, you will go orally, you will see only up to the esophagus, you'll have to admit the person in the operation theater, you will have to give general anesthesia and do this procedure. You can remove foreign object, remember, and the cost is more. This is your esophagoscope. Compare it with your bronchoscope, which has holes here. This is your esophagoscope. And whatever handle you have here, it shows the direction of the bevel at the distal end. This is the negus esophagoscope. Negus esophagoscope has twin proximal lighting, we are seeing. Negus, remember, okay? Then coming to, why will you do rigid esophagoscopy? In general, esophagoscopy, why you do? Whenever there is dysphagia, that is like you cannot swallow, right? Kind of thing. Because of cancer of the esophagus, because of achalasia cardia, strictures, esophagitis, diverticulae, etc. You will have to do esophagoscopy to check the cause of this dysphagia, to find the cause of retrosternal burning, which could be reflux esophagitis or hiatus hernia, where the stomach itself is herniating out of the diaphragm, right? Hiatus hernia, all this you can check. Then if there is hematemesis, the person is bleeding, the vomit has blood, then you can check for esophageal varices, right? Then if there is some secondary of the neck, when you don't know the primary unknown, you can do esophagoscopy to check. So that is diagnostic. Then therapeutic, you can remove foreign body. You can do, if there is some stricture, you can dilate it, okay, with a rigid esophagoscope. You can remove not only foreign body, you can remove benign lesions like fibroma, papilloma, cysts, etc. If there is esophageal carcinoma, you can insert some tubes like this one, Sautard's tube, or this one is Mossau-Barbin tube. All this, what is this called as? This procedure is called as some palliative, right? Palliative treatment for esophageal carcinoma, right? Then you have for esophageal varices injection. Corrosive burns of esophagus. So corrosive burns of esophagus, that time you will do esophagoscopy to check if there are burns. But if there is severe circumferential burn, the first one, don't go beyond that point in the esophagoscopy, okay? Then if there is stricture, what you can do as a treatment, you can do dilatation with bogies. This is a bogie, okay? You can dilate with a bogie, prograde dilatation with bogies. One of the treatment for benign strictures of esophagus. Remove foreign body, we told you, rigid esophagoscope, you can use to remove foreign body. But if it is soft or blunt object, you can remove with flexible scopes, okay? Then, rigid esophagoscopy contraindications, you should not do rigid one if there is trismus of the jaw, diseases of the cervical spine, receding mandible, if there is aneurysm of aorta, remember this can be fatal hemorrhage, fatal hemorrhage can be there, if there is aneurysm of aorta, don't do rigid esophagoscopy. If there is advanced heart, liver, kidney disease, don't do rigid esophagoscopy. Anesthesia, you will give general, mostly general for rigid, and for others you can give topical. Position, it is very similar to direct laryngoscopy. The patient will lie supine, head is elevated, neck is flexed, head is extended at the atlanto-occipital joint. So what will happen, you want to bring the axis of the mouth, pharynx and esophagus in a straight line. That's the whole point, right? You want to bring the mouth, pharynx and the esophagus in the straight line. Okay, then what is the technique? You will place a gauze on the upper teeth. See, upper teeth, they're placing gauze so that you don't hurt the teeth. You will also protect the lips. You will lubricate the esophagoscope with jelly. Then you will pass it, how you will hold it like a pen and introduce it into the mouth by the right side of the tongue and towards the middle of its dorsum. Then what exactly you do? Four steps. Identify the arytenoids. Then go past the cricopharyngeal sphincter. Then you will cross the aortic arch in the left bronchus. And then you will pass the cardia. Cardia is of the stomach, right? How will you know that you have gone to the cardia? Because of the rugose mucosa. That's the stomach part. And once you're going, now we're coming back. Even while coming back, when you're withdrawing the esophagoscope, you should inspect the esophageal wall, okay? Then after you're done with this, you should give the patient some usual diet. Sip plain water, you can tell. And if there is... there can be, these are the complications, okay? Surgical emphysema can be there, so that can lead to intrascapular region pain, okay? If there is, patient is complaining of pain in the intrascapular region, there can be surgical emphysema of neck, so you should be careful. Abrupt rise of temperature, all this will indicate what? Esophageal perforation. Complications, guys, you can injure the lips, the teeth, you can injure the arytenoids, you can injure the pharyngeal mucosa. You can perforate the esophagus, especially at the site of the Killian's dehiscence near the cricopharyngeal sphincter. Then there can be surgical emphysema. So because of the perforation, there can be pain in the intrascapular region. And especially in children, there can be compression of trachea. You'll have to immediately withdraw the esophagoscope if there is compression of trachea. Flexible fiber optic esophagoscopy, this is an outdoor thing. You need topical anesthesia. You can not only see the esophagus, the stomach, the duodenum, everything you can see. It's an outdoor procedure. You can see mucosal diseases. Then basically, this has practically replaced a rigid esophagoscopy except for removal of foreign body. Transnasal esophagoscopy, instead of going by the oral cavity, you go by the nose, and it will be 2 millimeter working channel. Air also can be inflated through it. You can examine up to the gastric fundus. You can look for what is extra. All these are normal. You can look for, you can do a transesophageal puncture for a person who needs esophageal speech, and you can also take a laryngeal biopsy. Okay, that's it. We have taken a recap of esophagoscopy. Bye-bye.